Hi, this is Annie Gantz. I am an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Lore, Rutherford County, Western North Carolina, and beyond. I live in the western section of the county, almost 4 hours one way to the state capital in Raleigh. Of course, there's a vast amount of North Carolina to the west of me, meaning that most people cannot easily travel to the state capitol to be in person for what lawmakers are saying. Today, Thursday, June 6, 2024, let's see what lawmakers are saying with today at the NCGA. As a reminder, again, please subscribe because North Carolina General Assembly does not archive their live stream videos. As far as I know, I am the only person doing this. Therefore, this exclusive information is only archived because of my independent journalism work. Thanks for watching, and let's see what lawmakers are saying today at the NCGA.
I know for your side, Commissioner, you're all familiar with this. Scheduling in government is a very, very fluid concept, and it changes by the minute, somewhat like our weather. But in any case, again, my sincere apologies. To the members of the committee, please signify now if you think you have questions you'd like to ask so we can get your name down. Okay. We have Representative Dahl, Representative Cleveland, Representative Chesser, Representative Stevens. We don't have Representative Stevens anymore. Okay. So we will start with Representative Dahl. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Shoemaker, I just have a couple of questions for you.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I don't want to single you out. Also, is there a pending suit involving your company and North Carolina DMV?
Yes.
Okay. That's fine. So I don't want to ask questions because I feel like we're invading on that space. So when did you plan to come to this meeting for today? At what point did you decide?
We were extended an invitation from the committee maybe last week.
Okay.
I don't have the specific dates, but
you're good. That's all for you.
Okay.
I do have a question for you, sir. So when you took over DMV, was it running perfectly and up to par and there were absolutely no problems whatsoever?
We have a great team, but the short answer is no.
So am I to understand that when you took this over, there were problems that still needed to be corrected, there were issues that still needed to be addressed, not by anybody's fault, just as we all know, agencies do a lot of different things, as we just saw today. We had a conflict in schedule. But what I'm trying to get at, or what it appears to me, is that we're trying to somewhere find some blame in an area where we don't even know when it started. It could have started back in 1996. So I'm just asking, was it a perfectly run organization? No shame on anybody.
The answer is no, and okay. We have a great team. We're doing the best we can. The resources.
I'm fine with the team. I just want to know yes or no. If it was perfect, then okay. Thank you.
Representative Dahl, just to clarify, the purpose of the meeting today is to establish what happened with the current situation. DMV has always enjoyed a reputation of being an experience to have to deal with on the local level, and I think that's probably true in any DMV across the country, but it's an onerous task to try to go in there. They do a multitude of functionalities, from not just driver's license and IDs, but it's understandable that it'd be hard to get their arms around every facet of what they're asked to do and make it run like a Swiss clock. Representative Cleveland, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, are you aware, or were you aware at the time in DEMA opened up two production facilities that the state law did not allow for that?
It's my understanding that when the law that you're referencing, immediately prior to that law, you had approximately 115 driver license offices that created and manufactured the licenses and IDs on site. Once that law passed, it went to, instead of having 115 locations, we went to one company.
We went to one central location for the production of driver's licenses.
Correct.
Not one company.
One location, you're correct.
Okay, so you were aware of it?
When?
You were aware that the central location is fixed in law?
The location, but it is one company, and they are all, no, there's only one company.
It's not one company, it is location. So when NDEMA opened another facility, they broke our state law. And you, I understand, did nothing about this.
As I understand it, is that if they didn't use this second facility, then you would not have solved the backlog at all.
That was not my question, Mr. Secretary. NDEMA's problem was solving the driver's license problem. Your problem is making sure North Carolina law is followed. So I cannot fault the contractor for breaking North Carolina law when you, as the secretary, were aware of it. It did not say, no, you cannot do that. Then it would be up, I think, to the contractor to resolve the problem at the facility they were using, expand production or whatever they'd have to do. My problem is, why did you allow for your contractor to break North Carolina law?
We were advised that it actually did follow the law because the law doesn't take into account all of the circumstances of the DMV operation.
May I ask who advised you that the law was followed?
We've had discussions internally with legal counsel and that the...
Well, I probably shouldn't say that because I'll get in trouble. Legal counsel is fine. The law is very clear. And if you want to circumvent the law, legal counsel is a good way to go. I through my various and sundry careers that I've had through my life, have relied on legal counsel for dubious things. But me, as being the leader of the facility of the organization, I could not let myself do that. And I see that being done, and not only in your organization, I see it in other agencies that I have the pleasure of overseeing. And it's something that it really needs to stop. It really needs to stop, because if you look throughout government in its entirety at the federal and state level, we are getting away from the rule of law, period. And if we don't do it individually within our organizations, it just grows and becomes a larger problem. So I can't fault NDEMA because I don't think they were aware of it, but I do fault DMV.
It was their idea.
It may have been their idea, but did they know they, Ms. Shoemaker, did you know you were violating state law when?
No, sir.
Okay. So it was, the onus was on the department to say, no, we cannot do that. And it did not happen.
If I may, Mr. Chair, I have one brief response on that. The current law does not even take into account moving from one company to another. So if you were to interpret it the way respectfully you're interpreting it, we would have to shut down every driver license office in the entire state and then shift to a new company all at once. There's going to be a transition between two companies and two locations. So the current law is inadequate,
well,
respectfully.
Mr. Secretary, I could see your point and I could understand your point. But if that's a problem, you should bring it to the legislature and say, hey, we need a transition period when we change contracts. But that is not what we're discussing.
I'm asking today because this is just something that just happened.
This is not the place to ask for that. You can come to me in my other capacity and talk about it. Mr. Chairman, I don't have anything else.
Thank you. Representative Chester, you're recognized. Representative Cervantia, did you want to ask a question? I'll mark you down.
All right, just briefly. Commissioner, I was able to obtain a copy. This is relatively close to what you are under contract for with the new vendor, correct? This is the ID that's going to be produced.
That is what has been publicized, yes.
And in the bottom corner here, that's the color photo that was added after our last meeting, correct?
Pursuant to state law.
Pursuant to state law. So when the contract was entered, if you made a change afterwards, you knew you were violating state law when entering the first contract that did not have a color photo on it.
It was our understanding that the legislature had changed the law previously whenever there was a change with contractors.
Changing the law at a previous date doesn't mean that you were in compliance with the current law.
But it is in compliance.
Yeah, Madam Schumacher, was your company ever offered an opportunity to bid on anything that resembled this?
We were not. No, sir.
Okay. This gets back to kind of what we've been talking about. That little photo on there jacked the price up 35 cents or so from what was previously stated by you, 13 to 15% increase in price per unit. And we had to, the state had to buy additional equipment to make sure that was possible to be produced, roughly $4 million, according to your testimony earlier today. And we're not sure who paid for it. It's a pass-through cost. The taxpayers are going to pay for it. We know that. With all that in mind, do you still think that this is a competitively priced product when no one else was able to bid on it?
Yes, based upon what we have received, based upon what we know about the market, the few companies that provide these services, based on the fact that it's lower cost than what the company currently providing it had assigned.
Based on the current company providing a different product and no other bids being offered for this product. So the problem here is, as my colleague was getting to, is I'm seeing a pattern. The DMV interpreted a limited exemption that was granted to them from DIT oversight in order to allow five projects for purchasing and other things. And they use that exemption to enter into contracts that violate state law. You've already said that you've received counsel that said you were okay to do that. If I had general counsel that was advising me to break state law, I would probably seek other counsel. That's just me. That's not a question, sir. That's just me speaking. DMV agrees to pay higher prices to bring the product into compliance with state law. And now the DMV is again violating law because of bad counsel and bad decisions and bad advice and bad data.
May I respond?
Yep. There's a serious issue here. And I think it starts at the top. I don't think it's the rank and file members that need to be held accountable for this. They're trying to do their job. I think they're being set up for failure. And I think this was a solution in search of a problem. And I don't think that you as a director of an organization get to come to before the legislature and say, we changed our protocols, now you need to change the law. We changed how we want to do things, now you change the law. That's putting the cart before the horse.
Mr. Chair, may I respond? With all due respect, Representative Chester, I hear where you're coming from, but I disagree. We, before we even signed a contract, before we even went through the process, we informed in February of 23, I believe, to the Joint Legislative Oversight Committee on Appropriations that this was one of the that we were having various projects as part of the DMV-5. That law was adopted by the legislature, not at my request, but prior to my service, and we were following the law, and we reported that this is going to be along the way which projects that we were going to be selecting. That was before a contract was signed. It was and everything else in terms of what we forecast. I'm doing the best I can with the law that was adopted by this body.
that law gives you latitude in what projects you're allowed to award contracts in, not how or what the process is by which you must follow to award contracts.
That's not spelled out in the law. So, again, this is also subject to litigation.
Neither is the authority for you to do it.
We presented it, Mr. Chair.
Your time has expired. Remember specifically what the law states and reading from the actual law, the Department of Transportation allowed the DMV to manage, procure information technology, goods and services, and enter into contracts up to 5 information technology projects for the Division of Motor Vehicles. And I think Representative Chester's point and that of many others is that the awarding a contract for the production of a driver's license doesn't really pertain to upgrading your information technology. And under that definition, I believe is where the point is being made.
Mr. Chair, I respectfully disagree. Involvement of technology and information technology is all part of creating the DMV record for every customer in this state. It involves IT. Providing a credential is a service. It is a good. So with all due respect, I would disagree with your interpretation.
I would say we're getting down into semantics and stretching the definition to fit the need. But my understanding was the legislative intent was to give you the latitude to make purchases that would upgrade your technology, because are you not still on a COBOL system or something that's more or less antiquated by today's standards? And I think that was a legislative intent. So what has transpired can be argued about till the sun sets, but I'm simply telling you that is the interpretation, the literal interpretation of the law by many, many folks. Representative Cervania, you are recognized.
Thank you, Chair. I have very limited time. So I have one question for each. When you enter a contract, do you work with procurement with the state? And in this situation, if it's a tech or IT contract, that you work with IT of the state as well? And criteria of an RFP or entering in the contract is specified before you put it out to the public to be bid.
Yes, we work with procurement professionals, DIT, T professionals. DOT has its own procurement manual. I defer to the subject matter experts that are here on more specifics, but we follow the process.
And then is lowest cost the only criteria that you award a contract by? Is it quality of service, quality of partnership, weight? You were mentioning weight, quality of product. What is it?
You're correct. It is not just the lowest cost, quality of product and the type of service we will get. And the current company is not going to be our next.
And as an agency, you have the ability to determine that if a contract is not fulfilling, that you can go have a bid process happen to acquire another contractor, correct?
We would follow the appropriate processes for whatever the project is.
Yes, all right. Thank you very much, Commissioner. And then to Ms. Shoemaker, I have a concern that you have till June 30th to fulfill the requirements under your contract to come updated to your backlog. Do you have a plan that's compliant to our law, that's in agreement with the commission, to meet your deadline of June 30th, and then if you don't meet it, that you will fulfill the outcomes of that agreement even past the date? And are you requiring that we need to pay for that if you don't meet that deadline?
Sure, thank you for the question. So yes, we do have a plan. It is it's the current 2-factory plan, which obviously, you know, there have been some questions that have been raised about that from Representative Cleveland here today. So I'm sure we'll have to revisit that conversation post today's hearing. But as of May the 13th, with that plan, we should be resolved of the backlog from the February 20th incident before the end of June. There is a a process in place through the transition process with the DMV to allow us to continue producing the credentials that are transmitted to our facility to print up past the June 30th date. I don't know that that our company and DMV have agreed on any orders that would come in post June 30th that could come to our factory, but certainly all that is in our queue today would be able to be produced in our current agreement that we have.
Will you be able to provide that plan to us so we can?
Sure. Be happy to.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Representative Stevens. Are you sure you don't want to ask a question? Okay. Representative Cleveland, you're recognized for a question. He appreciates that.
Mr. Goodwin, or excuse me, Secretary Goodwin, in your conversation with Representative Chester, did I understand you to say that you presented this project as one of the ones that was exempt under the law during a conversation with the committee?
Not this committee.
I with a committee.
We indicated which projects we projected would be part of the DMV 5. The number, the projects varied as we got more information along the way, but we indicated that the changing of our systems project might be one of those, which is the one about the COBOL.
Indicating and saying is two different things.
Yes.
You had five projects that you could manage without DIT. And I thought I heard you say that you presented this as one of those projects.
At some point there has been a proposal or a listing of which items that we were looking at for the DMV 5.
What committee did you present that to?
I would have to go back. I believe it was one of the joint appropriation committees on transportation, but I would need to go back to my notes. But again, the list changed as we went.
I'd like to know, because it's been insinuated to me that this project was not one of the five that were originally envisioned. So if you could clarify that for Matt, I appreciate it.
Sure, be happy to clarify. I do know that, but in terms of the answer to the question was that the way we were interpreting the DMV 5, the list of projects changed over time, and be happy to provide that. But the answer to Representative Chesser is that we indicated this was our interpretation of the DMV 5, using them for, you know, goods, services, IT, and we talked about, I specifically recollect talking about how in one of the committees that IT is a necessary component of credential production. You can't create a DMV record without having information technology. That's how you create, preserve, and maintain.
You're getting beyond
the data.
I understand those aspects of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Cleveland. Ms. Shoemaker, I have a question for you. Where is that second, and I might have missed this somewhere, the second facility that you opened up?
It's an existing factory for IDEMIA, Springfield, Illinois.
And what was its functionality before you utilized it to help get the backlog?
It operates similar to the Sacramento factory. It has, I think we operate 9 different states, central issuance out of the SAC factory, and Springfield would be the same. So they've got a list of states that is their central issuance location.
Okay, thank you. And Commissioner Goodwin, when DMIA notified you that they were going to resort to a second facility, what were your concerns? I understand they notified you. They didn't consult with you about doing it. They simply told you that's what we're going to do. And I understand at that time, your priority is to get that backlog down and to reduce the wait time for the constituents across the state. But what were your concerns about it? You have a senior executive leadership team. Did they express any concerns to you about, well, as some of the members point out, state law and the central location?
Well, as indicated earlier, respectfully, the current state law doesn't reflect the fact that we would ever change to a new company, first of all, which is, I think, something that the future legislature should consider, because there's always going to be a transition, whether it's two companies in two different locations. It just won't work otherwise. We've had the same company since 1996, so the law that was passed does not reflect what needs to be needs to be in place for things to work. The bottom line is that members of this body, the legislature, asked us to solve the problem. They said you need to eliminate this backlog. We did not receive any information about how much overtime would cost. We also wonder how would overtime work if they're already a 24/7 facility.
Yeah, I'm sorry, sir. I think I know where you're going with that, but my question is, and you pointed this out in your first letter to me, co-chair Johnson, in your first paragraph, you say, and I quote, "I'm writing to you today to alert you about unforeseen and ongoing production delays for driver's license and state ID cards. As you know, the Division of Motor Vehicles, DMV, is required to have all credentials produced and issued from a central location, NC General Statute 20 dash, and you go on to cite that, unquote. Right. So you're aware of the fact that the law required it to be done from a central location. Now, read in your statements and heard you testify here today that you want to interpret central location as being a vendor, a single vendor who may have several locations. And you kind of compared that to the fact that we had 115 different locations. Well, we run that as a state, and that's dissimilar from the state statute that turns around and changes the whole paradigm to being from one location, and you apparently were aware of that there. So my simple question is, did anybody on the senior leadership staff say to you, Mr. Commissioner, there may be a problem here because we're going to two locations now? You still have one vendor, but that's not the law. Now, in regards to your other remarks about what needs to be changed, I don't know what point during your two years that you've been there now, at what point you looked at Ademia and said, we've got a bunch of problems here. It's an ongoing situation. We're going to need to look for a new vendor. But at some point, you made the decision to look for a new vendor and found CBN, however that happened. But prior to open up negotiation, once the decision was made to change vendors, why did you not approach the legislature then? And at that point, I'm talking about maybe President Pro Tem, Speaker of the House, and saying, guys, listen, or talk to Eric Boyette and say, we need to get the law changed so that we can do this and keep the horse in front of the cart. But there's a little issue with coming here today and saying the law needs to be changed, because to what Representative Chester's point, you seem to be developing a pattern. The department seems to have a pattern of interpreting statute as it best fits your need. And I understand your motivation behind it, but it's not justification for changing the law, whether it's color photos or various locations or anything along that lines. But again, did anybody come to you and your senior leadership team and point out that this may be a violation of state statute to open up a second facility? Did they express any concerns about security in that location in regards to constituents' personal information?
There was no expression of concerns about security, but the issue, the glitch happened in February. We weren't made aware, as you see in your emails, weren't made aware of a backlog until later in March. And then the backlog wasn't a huge backlog until April. So when would we have come to and asked for the legislative change? There was nothing to ask a change for, respectfully, until it just happened. I mean, we're here today, a month from the letter I sent to each of the members.
Right.
We're 2 months out from when we first learned of a minimal backlog, and it grew. So we couldn't come to you because there's nothing to come to you for until we were notified of a backlog. And we just now have had our agency bill that was heard in the Senate committee yesterday.
Madam Shoemaker, what date did you notify? And I have it on a timeline somewhere, but I don't want to take the time to look it up. What date did you notify the department that you were opening up a second facility?
May the 13th.
On what day, Mr. Commissioner, did you notify the General Assembly or the leadership of the General Assembly that there was a second facility being opened up?
Mr. Chair, May 13th would have been the day that the second facility started. I believe the notification was the week prior.
Thank you.
At the time of the letter, we were waiting on overtime options. And we did not have them then and still do not have them.
Well, I think that's an issue separate from the fact. If you were notified on, let's say, May 9th, I think I would immediately picked up the phone and notified Mr. Boyette that there was another facility, but it doesn't seem like that was on your radar, that that might be a problem.
We notified the Secretary Hopkins. We notified the senior leadership. This is not something that I decided on my own, Mr. Chair.
Okay.
And again, the issue is the legislators in this body had asked us to solve the problem, and the current statute doesn't provide enough answers to solve that problem. And we were advised this is the only way to solve that problem. If we had to, if IDEMIA shuts down its second facility, then you're going to have 100,000, 98,000 people.
Mr. Commissioner, I'm not arguing the fact that it was the right move. What I'm discussing is the right process that evolved around that. The lack of communication to the appropriate folks that should have been advised based on the fact there was an existing statute. Now, your response directly pertains to that situation, but in regards to the migration of information from IDEMIA to CBN, that is an issue. I agree with you on that, but at what point in your search for another vendor did you come to the General Assembly and say, hey, you know, there's no latitude in here for migrating information from, you know, as we transition to another vendor? And that's understandable because we have been with the same vendor since 1996. But again, the lack of communication, at what point, and have you yet to date actually spoken to anybody or has, to your knowledge, Secretary Boyette spoken to anybody about getting the legislation changed to make a caveat in there that would give the department the latitude to make that transition?
I've heard anecdotally that anything we requested was there was going to be limited to what's already in current bills.
Okay, thank you.
And Mr. Chair, the official notification was on May the 3rd.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I will get back to you in a second. You be patient with me. I'd made some notes and I'm looking for them now as we go through. I think Representative Cleveland might have touched on this, Mr. Commissioner, but in a follow-up letter to me, you and to Chairman Johnson, you had made a quote, made a statement, I quote, DMV has previously informed the legislature about a history of defective cards with the current company, unquote. And I know it's a moot point now because of, you know, you have a contract with another vendor, but, and I think Representative Mike Cleveland might have alluded to this. I would be very interested, and I know the committee would be very interested in knowing who you registered those complaints with and basically what the nature of them was, because the lack of communication is also possibly within the assembly. So we need to know where your complaints and any agency's complaints need to be given the respect and followed up on. And so I'd like to know where we lost the ball on that one. If you or your team could come up with a list of when you registered those complaints and sure. with who, I appreciate it.
There are people in this room who received them, Mr. Chair.
Well,
and also
for the record, I was not one of them.
Okay. Well, yes, sir, I understand, but we provided that. In fact, there have been 6 additional cases this month of the current vendor printing credentials where the persons of color's photos are defective. It's still happening. And the ongoing errors list, the defects list, goes back along, predates me. But we presented to staff of the legislature as requested a long list of information about those defects. And I'm not the subject matter expert, but that has been provided. I'll be delighted to provide it again.
I appreciate it.
Yes, sir. Be delighted to.
Mr. Chair, may I address that, please? From the error, the issue with the cards. So I did ask our team while we were on break about the number of cards that had been produced that the DMV had identified with dark photos. Of the, it's roughly 0.01% of the cards that are produced for the state of North Carolina, roughly 800 cards. We have been proactively working with the department to try and find the root cause analysis of what happened to produce those 800 cards, but also instituted additional quality control checks to manually review every sheet of credentials before they are mailed and distributed to try and address and find those before they ever leave the factory. But the reality is it is still a manufacturing facility. So, I mean, certainly 0.01% of defects of credentials is well within the SLA that the contract allows. And honestly, it's a very small number. Still doesn't mean that we're not satisfied with 100% perfection, and have certainly been working to address that, but that is the statistic. 2.6 million cards are produced for North Carolina annually. That represents about 0.01%.
Mr. Chair, there's an additional statistic that was omitted on that, if I may add.
I'm sorry?
There's an additional statistic I'd like to clarify for the Ms. Shoemaker, if I may.
I prefer to move on from that. If you'll provide me with the information that I requested.
Yes, sir. It's on page 3 of my statement.
Thank you. See, the other question I had was, Ms. Shoemaker, when you had made a request to the DMV that you would be allowed to, if they would approve a hold on production of all North Carolina jobs so you could focus on the issue of the 2100 card.
Yes, sir.
Is that what caused the backlog to amount to over 350?
So we were reviewing that during the break as well. So on March 4th, the backlog was about 138,000 credentials based on the number of days that production had been halted to address the errored file that had come over from DMV around February 16th. The 300,000 plus number that we are referencing is the total queue. You have to remember, there has not been a day during this entire process that the DMV has not been remitting their folios every day of, you know, for processing at the factory. So it's more of a compounded issue. It's roughly 138,000 credentials that were impacted during the days where production was halted.
Okay. Mr. Commissioner, when Edemia notified you and asked you if they could withhold the production, did you or your senior team, anybody look at what the impact would be to the department? Or the ramifications of stopping production?
Looking on page 3 of the statement, we received a message on February 20th where IDEMIA asked us, quote, will you approve a hold on production of all North Carolina jobs so we may focus on stopping those cards from being mailed? DMV, working with IDEMIA, agreed to what it believed was the best course of action based on the information presented to it at the time. We did not know that there was going to be that of the 2,136 cards, that's only 0.025% of all the cards.
I saw that in your opinion.
And so we didn't, the days that we approved, it appears by the data that I have, is that the days that the shutdown occurred was longer than what we had expected and what we had approved. Nonetheless, it started back March 4th.
What was the timeline that was approved, not the timeline, but the amount of time that was approved to stop production?
Based upon the third bullet point on page 3, it appears that a production hold date was to be approximately 6 days. Hold production February 19th through February 21st, and that appears to be a production hold date of approximately 6 days. I defer to what else is in the documents. We don't know why it went from that. I don't know why it went from that to March 4th. We were thankful that they resumed, but March 4th is not the date that we have that we did not expect it was going to be that long, particularly for 2,136 cards out of 50,000 a week, out of 8.5 million that they're responsible for.
Mr. Chair, if I may, we were communicating not only via email, but in daily meetings with the DMV staff. So if the commissioner was unaware, his staff was definitely aware, because I've interviewed every person at IDEMIA that had any conversations with the DMV staff around this situation. And we were very clear that we were requesting a halt in the production for all jobs. So that was never not communicated. I think the important fact here is that the DMV required that we do this manually. Just they would not agree to the failed folio process, which on officially has happened four other times with the state of North Carolina. They have agreed to a failed folio process in order to eliminate a file that should not be printed. And that was what we recommended as the most expedited way to resolve this issue, and likely would not have resulted in the length of time that production was halted, nor the backlog that was created because of it.
Thank you. Mr. Commissioner, are you familiar with the HAPSAP, or the acronym HACCP?
Probably ought to be, but no.
It simply stands for a Hazard Analysis Critical Control Points. In various industries I've worked at over longer than I care to admit, over the years, just about every organization's had one, particularly in the food industry. And what it is that you look at your process, whatever your business is, you're building widgets or whatever, you look from the supply end to the delivery end, and if appropriate, the storage end. And at each point, you analyze what could go wrong, and you develop a contingency plan to how to address that problem. And it doesn't sound like we have that there, and it doesn't surprise me, but it may be something you want to consider is looking at a hazard analysis at critical control points, developing contingency plans for when those situations, as bizarre as they may seem, you know, just an inadvertent glitch, as you said, in the software, how would I address that when it occurs? So you're not starting from square one and scrambling, looking for alternative locations to catch up on, but it's just a suggestion. Do we have any other questions from the committee? Representative Cervanium, and then we'll wrap up with you.
Thank you, Chair. I wanted to springboard from your question. On this document that was provided by House Oversight staff, there was a letter provided by Commissioner Goodwin and on May 7th and Ms. Schumacher on May 10th that was provided to the GA. So it'd be good in response to Chair Warren's ask if you can provide that to us, a copy of those. I'm not sure he heard that, but anyway.
Sure, I'd be happy to.
That's very good. And so that was a great question, but they did provide letters on May 7th and May 10th, both of them, to us. I'm just curious also where it went to. So, because it seems Chair Warren didn't receive it or us. I did want to ask one last question also on this document. It says on the 16th, there is only 135 cars that are affected. On the 19th, 1,448. I guess that was over the weekend. And then Monday was merely 553. And so it's still, I think all of my colleagues here are really wondering, you resumed credential production. Why didn't you all at Edemia just continue on with those post February 20th, on February 21, continue regular operation? And then just address these 135 on the 16th, 543, that could have just been so easy.
I wish that it were so easy, ma'am. It isn't. And unfortunately, the best practices around secure government documents like this is for them to be printed in chronological order. If you are jumping dates with the folios, the potential for problems it increases. And I agree with you from a reasonable standpoint. It's hard to understand, but I'm happy to set up a meeting with you with our factory team for them to walk you through exactly what that process looked like. But I also want to mention that the factory that is the central issuance location for North Carolina in Sacramento also produces 8 additional states' driver's licenses. And so when the DMV required that we do these pulling of these 2,100 credentials manually, it took people who would normally be operating in a manufacturing facility off of their jobs to sit there and look through thousands of mailed prepared credentials that went out. So it is a much more labor intensive process than would be, we would reasonably think it would be, but I'm happy to set up with our subject matter experts to walk you through that.
Perfect. You just actually prompted, and this is, I guarantee, my last question. when you established a second facility, because you said it's chronological order, did you pull everything from Sacramento and bring all products? So you did do it in
yes,
two places.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
We wouldn't have swapped files between the two factories.
You wouldn't have just taken off Sacramento and put it in some. Okay.
Yep.
I just wanted to confirm. Thank you. Yeah, we would have had to have had a lead time to determine which folios were going to go to that factory versus the Sacramento factory, hence the communication on the 3rd and the starting of production on the 13th.
So then what did go to Springfield then? What folios went to that? What?
I do not know the answer to that, but we can get that information for you.
Thank you.
Certainly.
Finish, Representative. Yes, ma'am. Any other comments or final questions from any members? Seeing none. Mr. Commissioner, Ms. Shoemaker, I want to thank you very, very much for being here today and appreciate your patience during our little lull there. But I think, as unfortunate as the incident was, as you seem to be on top of, I wish you the best luck going forward and getting that resolved and meeting your deadlines. Because having a form of ID is just, it's always been critical, but it's even more critical now given legislation in regards to other things such as voter ID and election laws and so forth. But again, thank you for being here. If nothing else, this, there's always, I like to think that there's always a silver lining around a rain cloud, and this has given us an experience to grow from and to learn from. I do encourage the department to look at possible weaknesses along the line of production or service, see where you can come up with contingency plans so your reaction time is further quicker. But again, thank you so much for your time being here and wish you all a great afternoon.
Thank you, sir.
This meeting stands adjourned.
There you have it, word for word from the Oversight Committee meeting held today at the NCGA. I will link to the documents in my notes on YouTube, and you may read that for more detail, including Commissioner Goodwin's full written remarks, which was a very interesting read. Thanks for watching. Again, please subscribe and share my work. I greatly appreciate your support. See you next time.